Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, and welcome to tonight's event, which is called Environmental Refugees, the Next Wave? We're going to have a really interesting discussion tonight, which has been brought to you by Wilfrid Laurier University, by the U.S. Consulate General in Toronto, by the Balsillie School of International Affairs, and by the International Migration Research Center, and financially made possible by the U.S. Embassy in Ottawa. So thank you to all our financial sponsors and our organizers again tonight. It's a wonderful crowd, and it's a nice mix of members of the public, fellow professors and academics, and students as well. And tonight, we have a real treat. We are going to have a really interesting discussion led by three of the world's leading experts on environment and migration, who we are very pleased to have with us tonight. And we're going to talk about three broad questions, looking into the future, which is what we know and what we don't know about this phenomena that's known as environmental migration, and what we should be expecting in coming years as we have this world which is increasingly being affected by environmental changes, many of them caused by humans, as well as rapid population growth in many parts of the world. And then, so the final question we'll concern ourselves with is, what can we do now to start getting ready as we start to see more and more people on the move because of environmental reasons? My name is Robert McLemmon. I'm an associate professor of geography and environmental studies at Wilfrid Laurier University. I'll be your MC for tonight. And I'd like to thank my co-organizers for tonight's event, Margaret Walton Roberts of Balsillie School and Laurier as well. Michael Opatowski of the Balsillie School, and Bettina Barova as well. So thank you guys for your help. It is customary at Laurier events to send out an acknowledgement to the Indigenous people of this territory, and recognizing that tonight's event is taking place on the traditional territories of the Neutral, the Anishinaabe, and the Haudenosaunee First Nations. So thank you to them. And to officially welcome you to tonight's event then, I'm not going to speak any longer. I'm going to turn this over to the President and Vice Chancellor of Wilfrid Laurier University, Mr. Max Blau. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Robert, and good evening, everyone. Wonderful to see so many of you here. I'm very pleased to welcome you to this public forum on the future of environmental migration, co-sponsored by Wilfrid Laurier University, the U.S. Consulate General in Toronto, and the Balsillie School of International Affairs. Climate change and environmental degradation will certainly influence global migration patterns. How we deal with mass movements of people across borders and among continents is one of the greatest challenges we will face this century. Tonight, we'll have a chance to engage in conversation with three of the world's leading experts on environmental migration and learn more about how Canada and the US can better plan and prepare for the changes to come. Tonight's event is part of a two-day workshop that has brought together leading North American researchers and representatives of Canadian, American, and British government agencies in a frank discussion of potential future displacements and migration and the policy-making options available to decision-makers. Our visiting researchers come from Georgetown, Cornell, Brown, the universities of Colorado and Minnesota in the United States, and from the Canadian universities of Guelph, Ottawa, Toronto, and Waterloo, and of course, from right here, the Balsillie School and Wilfrid Laurier University. It is not a coincidence that this workshop is being held in Waterloo. The post-secondary institutions in our region have a unique concentration of scholars in the natural and social sciences who specialize in studying the impacts of environmental change on humans. At Laurier, we are proud of our accomplished researchers, across many departments who tackle questions like the one under discussion tonight. We're also very proud of our International Migration Research Center and of our numerous chairs and fellows affiliated with the Balsillie School. Together, we create research and student training opportunities in the study of environmental change, population geography, migration, and mobility that are unrivaled anywhere in Canada. Let me now express, on behalf of Laurier, the Balsillie School, and the organizers of tonight's event, our sincere appreciation for the support of the U.S. Embassy in Ottawa and the U.S. Consulate in Toronto that has made this workshop possible. The U.S. government has taken an active role in advancing international climate policy, with President Obama becoming an increasingly vocal advocate for the need to assist and protect those who are most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. President Obama has warned on multiple occasions in the past year that by failing to control greenhouse gas emissions today, we jeopardize international security tomorrow, and we raise the risk that millions of people around the world will be displaced from their homes and livelihoods. The generous support provided for this workshop and the presence here tonight of so many officials from the U.S. Consulate General in Toronto provides further evidence of the commitment of the American government to respond to the human impacts of environmental change. We are very pleased to have all of you here, a very warm welcome. And it is now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Juan Alsace, Consul General of the United States in Toronto, who has traveled from that city to officially welcome you and to offer some additional thoughts on the importance of the issues we are discussing tonight. Mr. Alsace is a career senior foreign service officer. He's closing in on 30 years of service, and he doesn't look as though he's experienced 30 years of service. Before becoming Consul General in Toronto in August of 2015, Mr. Alsace was an assistant professor at Eisenhower College of the National Defense University. He has previously served at U.S. diplomatic missions in Turkey, Iraq, Chile, Spain, Pakistan, the Dominican Republic, and Ecuador. In Washington, he has served as the State Department Director of the Office of Caribbean Affairs and as Chief of the War Crimes, Democracy, and Human Rights Division in the Bureau of Intelligence and Research. Originally from Buffalo, Mr. Alsace is a graduate of Marquette University and obtained his law degree from the University of Minnesota. He has received numerous State Department awards and is a distinguished graduate of the National War College. Please join with me in extending a very warm welcome to Mr. Juan Alsace.
Thank you, President Blau, for that very kind introduction and for supporting this very important workshop and event. I'd also like to thank the following people for attending. Dean Richard Nemzvari of Laurier's Faculty of Arts, Chair Michael English of Laurier's Department of Geography and Environmental Studies, and Director John Ravenhill of the Balsillie School of International Affairs, as well as the International Migration Research Center, the University of Waterloo's Interdisciplinary Center on Climate Change, and David Alton of Climate Action Waterloo Region. And of course, I'm very excited also to see that there's so many students here, because in the ultimate analysis, this is why the school is here, and that's why we're doing this event here, because we're talking about what's happening today, but it's going to impact all of you in the future. So today and tomorrow, we've got some leading researchers and experts from Canada and the United States, along with representatives of both our governments, and I had a chance actually to meet with several of the folks who are going to be speaking to you today or this evening, right beforehand, and we spent about an hour talking about some of these issues. And I think you're going to be very excited because they're engaged, they're intense, and they're dedicated to addressing these issues, which are so very important to you. And we also have a colleague from the UK High Commission here as well, and we had a chance to talk to her. So we're all meeting here in Waterloo to discuss one of the greatest challenges we face this century, which is how will we deal with the human impacts of widespread environmental degradation, pollution, and climate change? And in particular, how are Canadians, Americans, and the international community more generally going to respond to the growing number of people who are displaced from their homes and forced to migrate because of environmental reasons? President Obama saw the effects of climate change firsthand during his trip last year to Alaska, where the sea is already swallowing villages and eroding shorelines, where permafrost is thawing and the tundra is burning, where glaciers are melting at a pace unprecedented in modern times. As President Obama stated, and I quote, "It was a preview of one possible future, a glimpse of our children's fate if the climate keeps changing faster than our efforts to address it. Submerged countries, abandoned cities, fields that no longer grow food. Political disruptions that trigger new conflict and even more floods of desperate peoples seeking the sanctuary of nations, not their own." This is a challenge that President Obama and Secretary Kerry have raised in public policy statements in the past year, as have leaders of many other nations, including Canada. This is indeed a global challenge. And so at last month's COP21 Global Climate Summit in Paris, the international community agreed to establish a task force to determine what should be done to assist people displaced by droughts, floods, sea level rise, and other impacts of climate change. As Secretary Kerry said there, quote, "We're talking about the impacts on whole cities of unpredictable and uncontrollable extreme weather events. We're talking about the impact on entire countries of fundamental shocks to the global agricultural system," end quote. The International Displacement Monitoring Center estimates that on average each year more than 20 million people are displaced from their homes because of natural disasters. This number does not include, and this we talked about this a little bit just beforehand, the very many people who are not suddenly displaced, but are nonetheless obliged to migrate because their livelihoods and their quality of life have been eroded because of environmental damage. And experts are telling us that these numbers are continuing to grow in the coming decades as the impacts of climate change become more pronounced and because of population growth in the most vulnerable countries and regions. And really, that does impact the poor as much as it does anybody else. Still, it's generally believed that the biggest impacts will be in less developed countries, in Canada and the United States, we have also experienced large-scale displacements of people for environmental reasons. We were all watching in the United States about 10 years ago with the impact of 2005's Hurricane Katrina, which is still being felt in New Orleans and coastal Louisiana. Also, the Deepwater Horizon oil spill of 2010, creating additional challenges for communities where livelihoods depend on the shores and waters of the Gulf of Mexico. We also have, in our own country, hold on a second, page. In both Canada and the United States, we mentioned the phrases the Dirty 30s or the Dust Bowl, and older generations will recall the tremendous hardships caused by droughts on the North American Great Plains. In fact, I read a book, which I commend to all of you, a couple of years ago entitled The Worst Hard Times by Timothy Egan, describing the Dust Bowl years as the greatest environmental disaster ever visited upon the United States and a powerful cautionary tale about the dangers of trifling with nature. So in short, we have seen the displaced people in North America in our history and in our own lifetimes, and we see them now in other parts of the world as well. Our European countries are currently grappling with one of the largest mass migrations that continent has seen since the Second World War. And most of those seeking a new life in Europe are fleeing war, conflict, and poverty in the Middle East, Afghanistan, and parts of North and Eastern Africa. And that's another thing we were talking about briefly before we began here. How does that environmental degradation affect, you know, political conflict, some things that we're possibly seeing in Syria and other places as well, some of the literature talks about this, and I'm certainly hopeful that some of our experts today will have a chance to talk about that, and that you will be able to question them about it. Just last October, at the Climate and Clean Energy Investment Forum, Secretary Kerry said something that I thought would like to share with you tonight as well. And he said, "It's becoming even more clear with every record-breaking drought, every record-breaking flood, every hottest month ever announcement," and these seem to come every now and then, you know, if this is another record, "every year, the hottest year that we live through, with every peer-reviewed study that details the catastrophe that climate change could unleash, and frankly, that we're already seeing in certain places. In many places where conflicts are occurring, climate change, social instability, and drought conditions have been contributing factors to the conflicts that are leading to migration, and we're seeing that certainly in Europe right now, in Syria, in the Middle East. So as the impacts of climate change and environmental degradation intensify around the world, what does this mean for large-scale migrations in the scale we are currently seeing in Europe?" And really, that's what this event is all about tonight. At this public forum, we will be asking three internationally known scholars to help us do three things, and Robert touched on these. You know, describe what we currently know and don't know about global environmental migration. Identify the types of scenarios that we are likely to experience, and identify the options available to us in North America, here in Canada, in the United States, and Mexico, so that we might prevent worst-case scenarios from happening and how we can best deal with the scenarios that actually do. And also, we're very much interested in hearing from you. As I said at the beginning, you know, this is going to be impacting you as much as anybody, so we really look forward to your questions, your concerns, and really have a good dialogue here tonight. So if you have questions that you want to put to the panel, I guess there's a couple microphones that will be up front here and to share your thoughts. And so thank you all for attending, and I'm pleased to ask our Master of Ceremonies, Robert McLennan, to introduce our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Oh, sorry. Thank you.
Thanks, Robert.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And while Mr. Blau and Mr. Alsace grab some more comfortable seats in the audience, our panelists will make their way to the front. As was mentioned, there are microphones up near the entrances to the room. And after our panelists have had an opportunity to just give 5 or 6 minutes of opening remarks, then we will open it up the floor to questions from you as well. So thank you again for those introductions, and I will briefly introduce all three panelists, and then we'll ask Professor Hunter to begin. Our first panelist, to my immediate right, is Laurie Hunter, who is a professor of sociology at the University of Colorado Boulder. She's also the associate director of the Colorado University Population Center, and her research concerns environmental degradation and its impacts on rural livelihoods in South Africa and in Mexico. Our second panelist to speak today will be Dr. Elizabeth Fussell, who is a sociologist and demographer at Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island. She studies Latin American migration to the United States, and she also studies population change in the wake of Hurricane Katrina and its impacts on the city of New Orleans. Our third panelist tonight will be Professor Elizabeth Ferris, who is a research professor at Georgetown University, where she studies governance and human rights, particularly in the context of people who are displaced from their homes because of environmental reasons. So with no further ado, I am going to turn the microphone over to Professor Hunter. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. What an absolute honor to be here. I want to say thank you to Professor McLennan, thank you to President Blau, thank you to the folks at Laurier for hosting this important workshop, the leadership of Consul General Alsace. Thank you very much for your support as well. So again, I'm Laurie Hunter from the University of Colorado at Boulder. I've been researching migration and environment connections for a very long time, something that's very near and dear to my heart. Honored to be here to talk with you about it and really looking forward to your questions and comments. So I'll start first by talking about migration very generally. Migration is a well-studied phenomenon. We know a lot about the age patterns of migration, gender patterns of migration, the ways in which it's related to educational levels. Those kinds of things have been studied for a long time. But you know, in the last few years, a climate signal is showing up. And scholars of migration have started to think about the ways in which, above and beyond age, gender, and education, we can now understand patterns of migration through a climate signal, right? And changes in precipitation and changes in temperature now contribute explanatory power to our understanding of migration in a way that they didn't before. So we are really entering a different period, and so it's very important that we're thinking about this tonight. So I wanted to make five key points in my few minutes of introductory comments. And you know, when I thought about how to organize them, I realized that the word civics actually allows me to structure my comments, and I thought, wow, civic is about community, right? And what's what we're talking about? We're talking about community. We're talking about individuals, livelihoods, lives, origin areas, destination areas, and the ways in which this new era we're entering into might shape or reshape communities. So civics is how I'm organizing my points. The C stands for continuum. And when we think about the way in which the environment shapes migration, we have to think about a continuum. There are sudden onset natural disasters where people are forced to evacuate. That evacuation might be short term, or it might turn into something that looks a lot more like permanent relocation. On the other hand, there's long-term chronic environmental strain, one-year drought, two-year drought, three-year drought, four-year drought. Maybe it's in that fifth year that a household finally decides they have to move. Maybe they decide in that fifth year they're going to send somebody to an urban labor market to make money and send back as remittances, which then help them cope with the sixth year of drought. So there's a continuum, and that's the C in my civics. I'm going to skip the first I in civics because that didn't work. So we're really going civics. So V in civics stands for varied. And that has to do with the amazing variety of ways in which the environment influences migration. So Professor McClemon mentioned that I do some research in Mexico, looking at the ways in which rural Mexican households send migrants to the U.S., and have found that after 2 years of drought, households are much more likely to send a migrant to the U.S., as opposed to even just 1 year of drought or even longer. So there is an environmental signal. But you know, a new study came out just within the last couple of weeks in the journal Climactic Change that looked at this connection in five different African nations. And in each nation, the impact of precipitation and temperature was different. So the ways in which climate or environmental change will impact migration is varied. That's the V. The I, internal versus international. Most migration happens within a nation's borders, internal migration. Most climate migration will likely also happen within a nation's borders. That's because international moves are very expensive and very risky, right? So when we think about climate migration, it's important to distinguish whether or not we're thinking about the probability of migration within a country or across countries. So that's the I. The C in the SVIX stands for collaboration. And I mean there collaboration between research and policy communities. So researchers, we're over here doing our thing, asking questions that we think are important and interesting, but we often do that kind of in our own little vacuum. I think that researchers really need to communicate with policymakers to better understand what questions they need answered in order to develop better policies and programs in response or out of concern with climate migration. So the research and policy communities need to collaborate and communicate in order to know that the research can be better defined, and that also helps the policymakers access the information that might be available to help them better inform their policies and programs. So collaboration. The S is for stay, which I know is kind of funny because we're talking about migration, but you know, most people want to stay. So Professor Barry Smith is here. He does work on Pacific Island states. You know, even in these small, very vulnerable nations where sea level rise is literally in their face, people want to stay, right? These are our communities. This is our culture. This is my family. These are my friends. So most people actually want to stay. So picking up and moving as a result of environmental strain isn't necessarily a foregone conclusion. So those are my 5 points. I hope they offer some fodder for discussion later on, and I really look forward to that. The C stands for continuum. Remember, a continuum of influence. The V stands for varied, the variety of ways that environment interacts with migration across the globe. The I is internal versus international migration. The C is for collaboration across research and policy communities. And the S is for stay, because that's what most people actually want to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fussell.
Thank you. And I reiterate all of Lori's thanks for you for attending this conference tonight and for all of the sponsorship that we've received. I just think it's so important, particularly that young people, members of the generation who will be experiencing many of the impacts of climate change, really pay attention to the lessons that we're learning and make sure to incorporate them into your lives and work. So I'm going to follow Lori's civics lesson with a case study of the kinds of migration that were set in motion when Hurricane Katrina struck New Orleans. So I'm going to be a little bit challenged to put your civics acronym to the test, but in terms of the continuum, this is a rapid onset disaster or weather event. Okay, so we skip the I. And I am going to talk very explicitly about the variety of migration types that were set in motion by this event. This is mostly internal migration, although there is an interesting international angle that I'll let you know in on. And then the C for cooperation between, the Katrina really was such an extreme event that it really put a lot of policies to the test. And so we've learned a lot from taking these lessons from New Orleans and then figuring out where we did things badly. Stay. People stayed in New Orleans. They left when they had to, but they've come back. And a lot of people think they're crazy for doing that, but there are good reasons, and I hope to illuminate some of those with my example. Okay, so after Hurricane Katrina happened, New Orleans became basically the poster child for climate-related migration. And so it's really worthwhile to pay attention to the lessons we've learned from it. Let me just review, because I know a lot of you were really young when Hurricane Katrina happened. It was 10 years ago. Hurricane Katrina was a Category 5 hurricane, so one of the strongest hurricanes that you can measure. And it made landfall just east of New Orleans, which actually wasn't the worst case scenario. The worst case scenario would have been if it had made landfall at the mouth of the Mississippi River, because then all the water would have been pushed back up the river and so much more, it would have surely overtopped the levees. But the storm surge that accompanied it did in fact cause this many of the levees to be overtopped and to break down. So the protective levees that surrounded New Orleans and some of the other parishes or counties along on the coast of Louisiana failed. And I'm just going to focus on the lessons we learned from the city, because that's what's been studied the best. 80% of the land in the city was inundated. That meant that the flood, and also because the city is below sea level, and normally rainwater would be pumped out of the city, that water stayed, and it stayed in the city for 6 weeks. The pressure from that water on all of the urban infrastructure, the roads, the underground pipes, the electrical system, destroyed so much of the urban infrastructure of the city that, when you think about it, it took centuries to build up the city. So that destruction was really intense and meant that it was going to take a lot of effort to rebuild not just the homes that were flooded, but also the whole infrastructure of the city. So over half of the housing units in the city were made uninhabitable by the floodwaters. The rest were, nearly all of them were damaged, but some of them were still inhabitable, such as my home, because I lived there at the time. Our house was not in the floodwaters, but it was still received damage. So that was sort of we got off easy. In addition, many people, because of all of this destruction, many people were displaced from their jobs and the economy was really slowed down. So the idea that people could go back to the city and just sort of pick up in any quick way was unimaginable at the time. A year later, in 2006, only half of the population of New Orleans had returned. And so there had been about 500,000 people living in the city before Hurricane Katrina, and only half of them were back a year later. So clearly, this event set in motion several different migration streams. I'm going to talk about all of the four major streams that we can observe. So the first was the evacuation. About 75% of the city left prior to the hurricane's landfall, and then the remainder, except for a skeletal crew of first responders and a few holdouts, left in the week afterward. And many, we watched on television as those people who were in the Superdome and in the convention center were evacuated out of the city in that week. And it was really shocking to see this happening in the United States. So the evacuees, along with the rest of the disaster-affected Gulf Coast, formed the largest environmental migration since the Dust Bowl migration of the 1930s. Over a million people were displaced from their homes after Hurricane Katrina. After this evacuation, there was a second migration, which was the return migration. And this return migration was very unequal. Those people whose homes were not badly damaged or who lived in areas of the Gulf Coast that hadn't experienced the same kind of destruction to the infrastructure and economy were able to come back rather quickly. But in the city of New Orleans, nobody came back in that first 6 weeks when the floodwaters were still there. And then after that, they trickled in proportion to the destruction in their homes, but also to their resources and what resources they had to recover. So there were a whole lot of reasons why the recovery migration was very unequal. We were only able to observe that inequality by looking at the population characteristics of New Orleans a year after Katrina to see how different they were from before. And what we were able to observe was that the city's population on average was older, whiter, and wealthier than it had been before the hurricane. So from that, we inferred that African Americans, who were the majority population in the city, but also the largest minority group, and low-income people, and young people, particularly children, were less able to return to the city after the hurricane. So the other side of that coin of return migration is long-term displacement. So the people who remained displaced a year later and sometimes for much longer periods or who never returned, it's hard to make a generalization about who they were. We can look at them, we can see who wasn't back and infer that those were the people who were more likely to be long-term displaced, but we as migration scientists actually have no data that's representative about who was displaced and where they were, what their living conditions were like after Hurricane Katrina. And so we don't really know very much about the people who were trying to recover outside of New Orleans. So I think of them as being sort of two groups. Some of them were trapped in place by a lack of resources to rebuild and return. In other words, they didn't have, even though they might have wanted to come back, they just couldn't. They were trapped in found themselves after the hurricane. But then others might have made a more voluntary choice not to return or to delay returning because of the lack of affordable housing in the city, the slow reopening of the public schools, the diminished healthcare system, and the diminished labor market in the city. So all of those informed people's decisions. And then, of course, there were other people who returned to the city and then left again because they made another choice, which was, this is not a viable place for me, and so they wanted to move on. So it's really difficult to know. There was just this churning of the population as people tried to assess what was the best option for them and their families. Then finally, and here's the international migration component, there was a stream of people who arrived in New Orleans precisely because of the opportunities that were created by the disaster, the recovery opportunities in the construction labor force, and also in all the other kinds of services that were created by the recovery and the infusion of federal dollars. Many of these were Latino immigrants who were foreign-born and who make up a large part of the U.S. construction labor force. And others were young, educated professionals. So today, New Orleans population is about 85% of its pre-Katrina size. And the city looks like it's mostly recovered. So it's a great place to visit. You should go visit. It's not a disaster zone anymore. So to summarize, there are many kinds of migration that occur as a result of this particular environmental change. And the reason why we really need to continue studying Hurricane Katrina is because it gives us an opportunity to understand the kinds of decision-making that people engage in when they're faced with this kind of event, and even for years after as they're trying to decide how to recover. It also gives us an opportunity to think about how we can do this better, how we can help people recover better, so that the choices that they make the place itself more resilient to future environmental catastrophes or disasters, and also how we can do it so that the kinds of injustices that we saw after Hurricane Katrina are not duplicated in future recovery efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. And I should point out, too, that Dr. Fussell has been a stand-in for another one of our invitees who couldn't get up here from Washington, D.C. because of something called snowpocalypse. Apparently, they're getting a tremendous snowstorm. But we do have one person who made it up from Washington who might be a refugee for a few days if she doesn't get back because of snowpocalypse. Thank you, Dr. Ferris.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. It's great to be here, and it was a wonderful day talking with researchers approaching this crazy issue of environmental migration from different perspectives. This is a new field. There are a lot of things that we don't know as we listed today, and different approaches and different assumptions, and people working in different disciplines who sometimes use different vocabularies. For those of you who are thinking about possible research topics for papers, pick this one, because it's really interesting and it's manifest in lots of different ways. Now, I'm particularly interested in influencing policy. I do research because I want policymakers to read my work, to say, aha, we should do something about that. But in this field, there are several real dilemmas to how researchers can present research in a way that influences policy. And so I'd like to talk about a few of the dilemmas we face. First, as researchers, how do we be true to the fact that migration movements are multi-causal? In other words, that, as you mentioned, it isn't just an environmental event usually. Usually it's a constellation of economic, social, family, and environmental issue that surges. The case of Katrina is perhaps a little unusual in that it was a sudden onset disaster and people left very quickly. But those are maybe the easy cases. The ones that aren't so easy are drought, or when you see a progressive deterioration in the environment. You know, what makes some people move and some people don't? We can't say, for example, that any particular storm is a result of climate change. We can look at trends and patterns and say the patterns are that sudden onset weather-related disasters will become more frequent, more unpredictable, stronger. But you can't say that Hurricane Katrina was the result of climate change. So trying to be true to that multi-causal dimension of this kind of movement is hard. A second dilemma is the words we used. And here you've used environmental refugee. You may have seen climate change refugee, environmental migrant, environmentally induced displacement, climate change induced displacement, eco-migrants. New terms coming out are survival migrants, crisis migrants. Lots of different words, and words matter. Words have different legal meanings, different traditions. We see in some of the characterization of Syrians fleeing, if you call them migrants, it's a different thing than if you call them refugees. People who work with refugees hate the word climate change refugee. It's like somebody running their fingernails on a blackboard, because the refugee has a very precise legal definition. And there's a fear that if we start talking about refugees from climate change or snowstorms, that somehow we're weakening these precious international instruments that are already under threat. But if you don't know what to call something, and you don't know how much of it to attribute to environmental factors, it makes it hard to make a convincing case to policymakers that something should be done. Moreover, policymakers, like many of us, respond to numbers. We know there are 4 million Syrian refugees, and that's a bigger crisis than if there were only 4,000. Well, how many people are going to be expected to move as a result of environmental factors or climate change? From the very first report of the IPCC in 1990, it was widely understood that movement of people would be one of the main effects of climate change. There have been dozens of studies and different kinds of models, and the results are all over the place. Somewhere between 50 million and 1 billion people have been projected to be moving as a result of climate change, not counting other environmental factors. Many reputable scientists are moving away from making predictions. The migration experts say it isn't automatic that sea level rises 1 meter and therefore everybody living within such and such a distance of the coast will move. It's not so simple. Human beings are complicated. They want to stay. They find ways to stay or change their houses or move up on stilts or something. But if you don't have numbers and you don't have a term, and it's hard to explain the cause, it's difficult to be effective advocates if you want policymakers to do something now to prevent what's going to happen in the future. There's also an ethical issue involved. Should people who are displaced or who migrate or who flee from the effects of climate change receive preferential treatment to those who are just fleeing poverty or war or maybe other kinds of disasters? I mean, should somebody leaving Haiti because of the devastating earthquake in 2010 be treated less preferentially than somebody leaving because of long-term effects of climate change? You see what I mean? There are some assumptions we're making about who should move to the front of the queue, who should be let in first, that needs some thinking about. Just briefly want to mention a couple of initiatives that are underway to deal with some of these issues around movement of people resulting from environmental change. One is the Nansen Initiative. It's an international effort to look at cross-border disaster-induced displacement. Let me say it again. It's kind of, these lawyer types, they have these complicated ways of describing things. But when people move across an international border because of a sudden onset disaster or a slow onset disaster, the cases frequently cited is the Pacific Islands. As sea level rises, people will be forced to leave their country. But there are literally hundreds of examples of people who've gone to another country because of a natural disaster. The Nansen Initiative documents these initiatives. 26 countries, including Canada and the United States, have some mechanism for responding to people who are in another country or cross an international border because of a disaster. Exciting things are happening as we start to explore what this system might look like. The second initiative I'm involved in, together with the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, now UN University in Bonn, in Germany, looks at this phenomenon of planned relocations. What happens when a government has to move people, relocate people, to protect them because their habitat is no longer safe? There are cases where it's the government's responsibility to help people move to safer places. Evacuations, as we saw in New Orleans, is kind of an initial emergency. But what about if they can't go back? What about if, because of the destruction of the environment in Alaska, for example, as a result of climate change, communities can no longer survive where they are? Right now, there is no guidance for governments on how to do this responsibly in a way that protects the human rights of those who are relocated. The experience we have with widespread relocations following dams and other big infrastructure projects are almost all negative. Almost always, most people are worse off after they've been resettled than before. I mean, what can we learn from that and from other traditions about, you know, developing some basic guidance? You know, planned relocation should be a last resort. You know, don't turn to it first. People want to stay where they are. People should be consulted before you just move them. So we've developed a set of guidance that we're now circulating and discussing with governments. And the next step will be to develop some operational guidelines on, you know, what does it mean to inform people? Do you just have a one-off meeting and say, okay, folks, this is where you're going. Get ready. The buses are leaving next week. Is that informing, consultation, participation? How do you do it in a responsible way? I think these are some really cutting-edge issues for researchers and policymakers alike. And to be honest, nobody has the answers right now. We're all struggling to figure out how to ask the right questions and develop the right methodologies and get the, you know, representative cases to look at. So these are really exciting times in this field, and it was great to have a chance to talk with people in different disciplines and different approaches today. I'm a big believer in these interdisciplinary international gatherings as we struggle to tackle these challenges that confront us. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Well, I think you've had a good sampling of the type of research and the type of interesting and really important questions that our panelists are engaged in on a regular basis. So this will be your opportunity to start asking your own questions of the panelists as well. Note to all my students who happen to be in the audience that the professor looked very kindly on students brave enough to come to the microphones. There is one on stage right and one stage left, just here in front of the sound equipment. So as my students and the rest of the audience rushes to the microphones to ask questions, I would like to ask one that was actually raised in the opening remarks by Consul General Alsace, which, and I think I'll direct it to Dr. Ferris, which was this question of the drought in Sudan. In Syria. There was a drought in Sudan. I'm thinking of a different conflict. The drought in Syria, because between 2007 and 2010, there was a severe drought. And I don't think anyone says, well, the drought caused the civil conflict. But a lot of people wonder, what is the contribution of something like that? Would you like to tease that out a little bit for us, please?
Sure. It's really interesting to look at some of the studies that have been done on the relationship between the drought in Syria and the conflict. But hundreds of thousands of people were displaced from rural areas to cities. They moved to cities. Most of them, many of them, couldn't find jobs, were living on the margins of society. The government didn't respond in a way that met their immediate livelihood needs. And some are, you know, positing that this was one of the contributing factors, never the only factor, leading to the Syrian civil war. But you know, Robert, you mentioned Sudan, and Secretary General of the United Nations went to Darfur and said, this is the first climate change conflict we've got. And looking at the confluence between environmental factors, politics, I'm a political scientist, so I see politics everywhere, but you know, politics and environmental change and economic inequality, these all work together in a way that can produce conflict. So while environmental issues are usually not the only cause, they're frequently a big contributing factor.
Thank you. Did either of the other panelists want to comment or take on a new question that we've got from the audience? Okay.
Hi, this is a question for any of the panelists, whoever wants to jump in on it. Just Alaska was brought up, and we talked about the sea level rise and climate change contributions to what's going on there. I'm just wondering if you've had any looks into or insights into what's going on with the indigenous people in those areas and how the climate change has affected them directly or indirectly.
Sorry, I'll jump in on this one too. Yeah, and Alaska's a really fascinating case because there are a number between 17 and 19 indigenous communities that themselves have decided that they need to move because of the effects of climate change. I mean, it's really dramatic, as you mentioned in President Obama's remarks, with the coastal erosion, the barges can't get in, bring their once-a-year fuel allocation, the permafrost means that the sewage systems are no longer functioning. But the communities have decided this, the Army Corps of Engineers agrees, ex-Governor Palin agrees, these people need to be moved. There is no mechanism to resettle or relocate people in this way. Other studies have shown impact on indigenous communities in Siberia, in Norway, in Greenland, of the effects of climate change on the movement of people in ways that are presenting real challenges to the maintenance of indigenous culture.
I want to also comment that in Louisiana, there are also tribal communities who live on the Gulf Coast and make their living in the waters of the Gulf of Mexico. And they also are on they're losing their land because of relative sea level rise, coastal subsidence, and the higher waters. And what's really troubling about them, what they are troubled by, I should say, is that their identity as a tribe is very much tied to their land, and that land is disappearing. And the federal government and the Bureau of Indian Affairs in the United States has no way of saying, oh, well, we'll just allocate you different tribal lands somewhere further inland. And so for them, there's this incredible disincentive to relocate, even though they are literally being washed away, because it's a lot. So much of their history, their culture, their identity, but also some of their rights are tied up with having land. So it's particularly, I think it's even more troubling for tribal people than it is for those of us who just own property.
Thank you. And as people make their way to the microphones, I did take the opportunity to ask my class, because I teach a course in environmental migration, some advanced questions for the panel that I'm going to spring upon you now. I'm going to start with Dr. Hunter. We've been talking about traditional livelihoods. You also work in South Africa, as you mentioned, and you alluded to it in your talk. But would you care to let us know exactly what's going on in terms of traditional livelihoods and environmental degradation in South Africa, please?
Sure. Thanks. And I was actually going to add South Africa to your answers, too, with regard to local culture. Because where I do my work in rural South Africa, it's up in the extreme northeastern part of the country, and it's an area that was a homeland area during apartheid, so where black South Africans were forced to migrate, an area that still is pretty high population density, very remote and very underdeveloped, poor educational infrastructure, poor transportation infrastructure, poor economic infrastructure, and a tremendous amount of dependence on the local natural resources. So I was thinking with regard to climate change, there are studies on indigenous communities, and the ways in which climate is impacting local environments, which are the sources of traditional foods, right? So I'm thinking about my area in rural South Africa, where local berries are used for beer, where local spinaches are the daily sustenance. And as climate changes and habitat changes, those kinds of resources will be less available, or they'll be changing as well. So on migration in rural South Africa, I've looked at the ways in which environmental change impacts households' engagement of migration as a livelihood strategy. And as opposed to what we were talking about in Mexico, in my study area in rural South Africa, households that have access to higher levels of natural resources are actually the households that are more likely to send migrants. And it relates to the idea of how environmental change or climate change can actually trap some individuals or households in place. So as opposed to picking up and moving, they end up having to stay. So in my study area, a lack of resources is associated with staying as opposed to moving.
Thank you very much. Are you making your way to the mic there? We've got a question to stage right, please. Are you one of my students?
I'm not.
Oh, well, you're welcome to join our class anyhow.
I'm a PhD student here at the Basel School.
Excellent. Well, thanks for being here, and go ahead.
Okay, my name is Masaya Llavaneras Blanco. I'm interested in two different scales of the issues you're talking about. One of them is the household. You're talking about households making the choice of sending migrants in situations of economic or environmental distress, or if we can separate them anyway. I was wondering if you have, and I'm sure you have, worked on the gender implications of these choices and how they play out in the different contexts. And I think they have to do with the variety of that you were discussing in your civics approach. And then also, on the other extreme, I'm thinking of the global implications in terms of global governance of international migration, and particularly the situation of states, and these are very specific cases, states that are likely to disappear. And this is a whole line of discussion on this area, is what's going to happen, particularly with the Pacific Islands that are likely to disappear. How are we going to think about the state system if we're talking about citizens that are not going to have a land to go back in any real material way? So I was wondering, maybe Professor Ferries has worked on this too. Thanks.
And maybe I could ask all of the panelists if they would like to contribute on this, because I think you've all looked at it in different aspects. And Professor Smith from the University of Guelph was called out earlier by Professor Hunter on his research on small island states in the Pacific. And I was hoping that while the panelists are answering the questions we just received, if you might make your way to one of the microphones, and maybe if you had any comments to add on the subject as well. Thank you. Dr. Ferris.
I don't know, one of you want to answer the question on gender and migration patterns?
What a great question, and so important. So a few years ago, I tried to write an overview paper on gender, migration, and climate, and was a bit discouraged that there simply was no research on it. Given that this whole climate migration research is pretty new, there hasn't been a whole lot on the gender elements yet. But this paper that I mentioned that just came out in Climactic Change actually found a really interesting gender result in Uganda. So in I mentioned that the environmental effects were different across the five different African nations that were included in it. In Uganda, it was the only place where female migration was responsive to the climate signal. And they posit that it's because of intense impoverishment, and the female migrants were not labor migrants, they were basically migrating for marriage. So in places where the migration had reduced the origin household's need for food and such, and a bride price was offered, the women were migrants, but it was for marriage, not for labor. So in other places, in the Mexico work that I've done, the migrants are usually male, at least the initial migrants, and so the households that remain in Mexico tend to be female-headed, which can challenge those households, and they rely very heavily on the remittances that the male labor migrants then send back. So really important question, and a lot more research needs to be done. But those are two examples of how it plays out differently across settings.
Maybe I'll jump in then on the question of the submerged Pacific Island states, and Barry can continue. First of all, most people will have to leave. Those islands will become uninhabitable long before they're submerged, most likely through, you know, difficulties in accessing clean water and acidification, et cetera. So they're going to see migration while they're still a physical territory. Under international law, there are certain characteristics to maintain a nation state. If, for example, you could have a government in exile, you might have a government from one of these countries that moves to another country and would maintain the nationality or the existence of the nation state. But these are new questions. You know, everybody's worried, and perhaps no region more than the Pacific, where the evidence of the effects of climate change are real and mounting. Barry?
Hello, I'm Barry Smit. With regard to Pacific Island states, we often imagine the image of water levels and people becoming inundated and therefore moving somewhere else. Most of the people a lot of Pacific Island states aren't susceptible to sea level any more than Prince Edward Island or Rhode Island. But the atoll ones are. But this goes to the questioner who preceded me here, who asked about the scale, household and global. If you go to the people of these islands, they don't wake up in the morning and say, oh my gosh, climate change is coming, I better think about moving. They're grappling with, how do I feed my family? How do I get enough food? We're getting overcrowded here. There's problems with our fish resources in the lagoon because of heating and coral bleaching and the rest of it. And how do I get a job for my family? The same sort of things that are common in many parts of the world. So if you look at it from that scale, and the young woman who was here earlier asked that, those are the things you look at, and you seek things to address issues of that kind. You need to go a longer temporal scale and a broader spatial scale to address the other issue which he asked. What happens when sea level rise and storms and salt intrusion means that they really can't live there, at least in the way they do now? And the options of building houses on stilts, which are currently being adopted, run out. Now, that's a huge question, and I don't think the global community has really come up with it. Some countries, Australia says, we're not taking you, or New Zealand says, maybe we'll take some. And so that's an ongoing issue. And your generation is going to have to address that. We haven't done a very good job. I'm going to just address the issue of the Arctic one, and the reason I'm doing this is to try and show some of the fascinating complexities of environmental change that people like me never imagined, even after working at it for years. So in the Canadian Arctic, people go out onto the ice, they call it out onto the land, because the land and the ice is the same thing, to harvest marine life. It's in a very important part, not only of their culture, but of their livelihood and of their lives and of their income. And they do it at what's called the flow edge. So imagine the edge of the ice. And that's where they spear or shoot or whatever, harvest seal, narwhal and what have you. Now these marine creatures, they're chasing the fish. And the reason that they hunt at the flow edge is because the fish go under the ice and the mammals go there to get a breather, and then the Inuit harvest them at that point. Now with changing climate, where that edge of the ice is changing. So they actually, some of them have to travel less to get to the flow edge and some of them have to get to more. And that's sort of the image we can imagine. But there's other things. When you're going out on the ice, in order to find a safe place, because the ice breaks up, and what's happening is the ice is breaking up in different ways, the ocean currents are changing, and so the people hunting find themselves drifting off to Greenland, and that's not where they live. So there's hazards of that kind. But the fascinating thing for me was, the young people, when they were going out on the ice, would go to an elder and say, at this time of year, what is the safe route to take? And they would say, well, go along here, and then at the big rock, turn across, because that's the safe place from our traditional knowledge. Yeah, people would follow that. Nowadays, that doesn't work. Their snow machine or their dogs and sled would go into the ice and they'd die or have serious injury. What we have as a consequence is this diminution of the value of elder knowledge and a breakdown in the relationship between generations, because the knowledge you gave me is actually not working now. Now, you know, I worked in the area of climate change impacts. Nowhere in my list of things was there something listed as breakdown of intergenerational relationships. So I'm sharing that with you for those of you who are looking at issues like this. There's so many things that we never imagine come as a result of climate change until we start looking like that. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor Smith. Thank you. I think we have a question from stage left, please.
Hi there. Wow, my voice sounds terrible in this thing. My name is Josh, and I'm a master's student from the Borsley School. I'm currently part of a project whereby we're co-writing a paper headed by Simon Dalby in the front row. The topic is the climate change security migration nexus. And something that we've encountered is states are framing the issue of climate change induced migration as a security issue or a matter for matter of security. So I'd ask the panel, how do you respond to the securitization of climate change-induced migration flows? Thank you.
Do you want to start?
Yeah, I think that is definitely a trend. You see more military establishments that are looking at climate change and its impact on security, particularly concerned about the way in which climate change may lead to increased conflict. You know, issues around resource scarcity, will that lead to competition, will it lead to conflict? So I think that that's one obvious thing. Frankly, I think a lot of researchers frame climate change in a security manner as perhaps a way of accessing funds. I mean, policymakers, you know, pay attention to conflict. You know, funders are interested in conflict and security. If you bring a security dimension to an issue, you may be better able to access funding to support your research in other areas. That I don't know how pervasive that is, but I've certainly heard a number of scholars say, oh, I'm just going to call this climate change and security so I can get a grant. And anyway, I've never done that.
So I would agree. We were talking earlier about the largest pool of dedicated funding right now for migration environment work in the U.S. is through the Department of Defense. So, you know, that shows you that the security angle is someplace the government, I guess, is willing to put money behind it. But it is a concern, and I think among climate conflict researchers, there is also concern that some researchers are too quick to blame climate change for conflict when actually, as we've talked about, it's one among many reasons that conflict erupts. And there are other, just as I was doing a recent lit review, I ran across an article that said a call for peace among climate conflict researchers. So the research community themselves saying, time out, you know, jumping on the climate conflict bandwagon is oversimplifying these hugely complex scenarios where it's environment, it's poverty, it's political instability, and it's all of these things combined.
I have a slightly different angle on this, which is that often even the disaster research tradition, which predates our knowledge of climate change, tended to have a very militaristic view of how you respond to disasters. And that's reflected in a lot of our hazard response policies that are very much about top-down policies, where the first responders come in and they may often say, well, we need to impose some sort of curfew or prevent looting and do this sort of thing. And so there's a very militaristic approach to controlling a disaster affected community. And I think one consequence of this is the loss of rights of individuals in that disaster affected community. And the cost of that is that you disempower the disaster affected population from helping themselves. When you treat that disaster affected population as if they were part of the security threat, or as if they need to be put into shelters and treated like they're in displaced people's camps, they're not able to do things to help to participate in the recovery of the the disaster affected place and to help themselves. So I'm just going to give a short example of this. After Hurricane Katrina, many of the Red Cross shelters that opened up had a lot of security around entry and exit from the shelter itself, but they also saw their job as just being to give people a bed to sleep on, a place to take, you know, for personal hygiene, and food. And I was working at the volunteering at one of these shelters, and the thing that people kept asking me for is, if you could just give me a phone or a computer, I can email or telephone my family, and they can come pick me up, and I can leave this hellish place. And the Red Cross had no communication capacity. And it was so disempowering of the population, but very typical of this kind of top-down approach. And so so that's a different angle on this question of how, what are the consequences of treating disasters as though they're a security threat.
Thank you very much. Do we have a question stage left?
I'm Roger Suffling. I'm from the School of Planning in UW. I want to tell you a little story, and then I want to ask you a general policy question. My father-in-law was a young man in Spain, somewhat younger than most of the guys in the crowd here. And his mother had died, which was a real economic blow to the family, as well as personal one. That was because of poverty, because they couldn't afford a doctor. Then the crops failed on the little small hoarding, because there was climate fluctuation going on during the 30s, as we've heard. So Dad says to my father-in-law, you'll have to leave, there's no food. So he goes away and he walks away into the countryside and eventually gets a job, ends up in Badajoz, but there was a civil war breaking out because of all the stresses. And they were shooting people in Badajoz, so he had to run away, and then he, of course, he became a soldier. And then he tumbled over the border into France, and no doubt some official said, so what category are you? Are you a political refugee or a what? It starts at a high policy level and it ends up with a border official or a refugee officer, you know, interviewing an individual and making decisions. How do you classify people?
Mm-hmm. I think that's what I really love about your story is that it reminds us that these are people with personal narratives and personal biographies. And, you know, when we think about migration flows or we're creating migration models and we're working with our statistical significance and concerned about our measurement, sometimes it's easy to lose sight of the fact that these are people. These aren't just data points. These are people with stories and with kids and with families and with futures. And so thank you for that. But I think your story also just illustrates the complexity and precisely what it is that I think all of us have been talking about is that the problematic problematic label of climate refugee because of the sort of unidimensional aspect of that. And if somebody is forced to move because of environmental pressures, it's likely a result of lack of options on lots of different fronts. It could be lack of education, it could be gender inequality. It's a complicated narrative. So I just want to say thank you.
But the international system we have distinguishes very much for the reasons of flight. And under international law, a migrant is assumed to be voluntary. A refugee is assumed to be coerced or forced. Different kinds of treatment at national borders and international, according to those labels. And some people are suggesting now that we get away from labels, that we treat everybody the same, that we just look at needs, not the reasons why people leave. And yet the modalities of how that would be done, just respond to people on the basis of need and not because of the reasons for which they fled, or just seem insurmountable to come up with some kind of good criteria. It's a very imperfect system. We were talking today about some of the historical reasons that this concern with refugees led to a refugee convention and a particular environment in Europe after World War II, when I think it was something like 80 million people were on the move. And, you know, but this was a product of a particular moment in time. Maybe it no longer fits the needs of today's world where you've got different causalities and different ways of moving, but this is the system we have.
Thank you. I think we have a question stage right.
In Professor McLemon's course, we... sorry about that. Goddamn.
I'll take your name and student number after.
In your climate change course, we learned about the Maldives and how countries like that are put at extreme risk of migration. I just wanted to know, from a policymaking standpoint, what steps does the global community take to deal with the migration of an entire population?
You're much more policy.
So far, the international community has not responded well to this question of what to do if a whole population has to move. You know, it's part of the international politics, again, of dealing with climate change issues. You know, what countries and what people in countries like the Maldives say is, we didn't create this problem. It's not our carbon emissions that are causing the changes that are going to force us eventually to have to abandon our home. The countries that caused it should be paying for it. Pacific Islands, you hear this all the time, you know, less than 0.1% of carbon emissions from Pacific Islands, and yet likely to bear the brunt of these changes. You know, so it becomes really difficult when you get into this blame game of who is responsible and who should pay and how should the international community respond. So far there haven't been any efforts to develop any policy alternatives or long-term plans. But there have been efforts by a number of governments to do something. The Maldives has moved people internally, trying to consolidate them on the safest islands rather than the hundreds that exist. Government of Kiribati promoting migration with dignity. If our people have to move, at least let's make sure they have skills and are competitive on the world's global labor market. So there are things that are being done, but so far the international community hasn't done anything comprehensive.
A great question. You have a great teacher, I think. thank you. I think we have a question stage left.
Thank you. Roberts at the Balsillie School, and I have very much enjoyed listening to the panel this evening. Thank you. I was interested at Beth Fussell's comments on New Orleans, and it made me think about how might climate change or climate change-induced migration, how might landscapes be remade in the wake of that? Because we think about these events and we imagine these landscapes will be kind of left bereft and deserted and abandoned. But I think the point about New Orleans that was so interesting is what happened in the wake of this disaster? And I think, you know, you think of Naomi Klein's work on disaster capitalism, and it's the argument is it allows the space to be vacated and remade by certain kinds of forces. And so I'm wondering if you have any comments, each of the panelists, because you work in different places, and I'm not sure if these events have come up or if there's any indication of the kinds of contestations that are happening. If people do leave, but if there is something to be salvaged, who's in a position to do that?
Well, I think with respect to New Orleans, the disaster capitalism was certainly at work. And there were a lot of people who came in, they were part of, to sort of take advantage of these opportunities for land grabs. And then there were also politicians who were strategizing themselves to try to figure out basically how to, like on the city council, since they are elected from districts, the more affected districts, that politician would lose their seat if they didn't repopulate that area. And so there were some interesting, you know, tensions about how do you get people to make responsible decisions that are good for the residents, not just for people's political careers or profits. So those were, you know, very much in play. What the outcome of it was, I mean, when you look at what happened, poor people were less able to come back. Poor people had fewer resources to come back. In the case, you know, there are several large public housing projects in New Orleans that had been very troubled areas, because we know that places where poor people concentrate, often there are other sorts of problems that get concentrated in those locations. So they disallowed residents from those public housing units to return, which is one of the reasons why the city became whiter, wealthier, and older. And they redeveloped them as mixed income housing projects for profit by these sort of, you know, public-private partnership, which meant that they were no longer public housing projects. And so, yes, there are many ways in which that played out to the end of creating more inequality. And I think that, and I've seen recent research that shows more broadly in the Gulf South, places that have experienced more hurricanes have also experienced the kind of greater inequality or growth in inequality as well. So that's, you know, one answer to how this plays out. But it's very complicated because there are many different institutions that are competing over that space. So then the question becomes, is there a way that we can try to slow down the process of recovery in such a way that, because there's this competition between speed of recovery and justice in recovery. And if you slow down the speed of recovery, you're better able to have equity in recovery. How do you create that balance? That's governance, a governance problem.
Thank you. I think we'll take another question stage left. If we could, please.
Hello, I'm also one of Dr. McClellan's students. I was just wondering, on like the terms of like initiatives that countries are going to do. Do you believe that it's going to be more of like on an international level or on a national level? Like, are countries going to come together and make initiatives together, or is it going to become more of like a like something that individual countries will do? And because this is such like a rising like issue now, and you know never really used to be, and there's like a lot more research like starting on it, is it going to be something that's going to like become more? Not necessarily an exact priority, but kind of like get like higher on the list of priorities of like initiatives for countries to be doing.
This is wonderful. You've got wonderful students. we can only hope. I mean, I think the Paris Accords give us hope that perhaps there is now an international arena where at least this dialogue can take place. And What was it called? The paragraph 50?
Article 50.
Article
in the 50. Paris
agreement. Article. I couldn't get that word. Where displacement and migration is mentioned within the context of that agreement. So, and that's brand new. Obviously, the agreement is the first time that international bodies have been able to get that together. But the fact that migration is even included in there is pretty incredible. So, and you know, the conversation we've been having today and we'll continue to have tomorrow is this collaboration between the U.S. and Canada. So even if it's not a global, perhaps there are regional collaborations that can happen to think about policies and programs. Thanks for your great question.
Sure. I mean, I think definitely the countries at the national level are developing national plans to deal with climate change. It's really across the board to varying degrees. I mean, I hope that we have strong international cooperation, but also expect that we'll have some good regional initiatives in the Pacific. Some wonderful things are happening. The Caribbean, wonderful things are happening. So, anyway, I think it'll happen at all levels.
Did you want to add something, Dr. Hunter?
It was actually on the question before.
Go ahead.
Okay. You sure? Yeah. The question before about rebuilding, I thought that was really interesting. Oh, thank you for that. So part of it is funding, and you mentioned governance. You know, Boulder recently had floods as well, and we've learned a lot about how government money is being available for rebuilding it back just the way it was. You know, just the way it was isn't always the most resilient. And maybe the best thing to do is to use those funds to rebuild in a way that's going to better withstand the event the next time. But that's a governance issue.
Thank you. We've got time for one last question tonight. Stage right, please.
My name is Monir. I'm a PhD student at Geography and Environmental Studies, Wilfrid Laurier University. I want to share one of our, you know, most recent work. It actually tells us the risks of, you know, categorization as we are talking about economic migrants and environmental migrants. We actually interviewed around 50 skilled migrants, Toronto-based Bangladeshi field skilled migrants, who are doctors, engineers back in their home countries. And we asked them actually whether the job or the, they are actually the economic migrants. Officially, they are the economic skilled migrants. But while we were interviewing them, we found that they are actually the one kind of environmental migrants because they had good jobs back in their countries. They don't have anything here because they are starting their life from the scrap. But they consider the, you know, the air, quality of air in Dhaka, quality of life, and these are, you know, officially economic migrants. But we often, you know, we do not consider that economy, the environmental reasons also motivated to them for the migration.
Thank you.
You know, this is something we were talking about. This afternoon is a really important area. If we think, you think about the first categories of individuals that might be departing in the context of a longer running environmental challenge are precisely those that you mentioned, the ones with most human capital, right? So the folks who are going to be able to get out in the, as they see sort of this looming challenge, are the ones that can. So who does that leave? It leaves concentrated poverty and intensified vulnerability in the places that are experiencing the challenge.
And I think that just about wraps up the time we have for questions. So on behalf of all of the audience, I'm going to thank everybody who spoke tonight, starting from my right, Professor Smith, Professor Ferris, Professor Fussell, Professor Hunter. I'd like to thank Consul General Juan Alsace and the U.S. Embassy and U.S. Consulate General for making tonight's event possible. I'd like to thank Wilfrid Laurier University and President Max Blau. I'd like to thank Balsillie School of International Affairs. I'd like to thank the International Migration Research Center. And most of all, I would like to thank you tonight for coming out here tonight. And I hope you have a safe trip home. And for those of you who are going back to the snowpocalypse in Washington, D.C., if you do have to be refugees in our city, we're happy to have you here in Waterloo. Thank you all.